Blackstone Publishing presents Crash Dive by John McKinna. This book is read by Jamie Renell. Dedicated to the commercial divers of the Gulf oil fields, this book is for you guys, and especially for Teresa, my wife. Prologue. The warm Lebanese wind carried the scent of burning cedar wood to the guard's nostrils. He shifted the hefty Chinese-made AK-47, adjusting the strap to relieve his cramped shoulder, and strolled slowly to the open archway in the wall surrounding the house. Leaning against the cool stone, he fished in his pocket for a cigarette, lit it, and gazed out across the Bekaa Valley. It was not the clearest of nights. High, ragged clouds crawled across the waning moon, obscuring its pale light completely from time to time. The shadows in the jumble of boulders and loose rock surrounding the house alternately faded and deepened as the light came and went. The craggy mountain that rose immediately behind the compound blotted out the lower stars to the north with its black mass. Rajim exhaled a cloud of smoke and stared out into the night in total boredom. To the south, and slightly below the elevation of the house, the Bekaa Valley stretched off to the horizon. Here and there, the flickering lights of watchfires marked the locations of small encampments, but for the most part the local area was blacked out. Only 3 days earlier, the Israeli jets had knifed in and bombed a cluster of houses into rubble at the north end of the valley. Hamad, the other guard assigned to the gate, entered the archway and stood beside his comrade. He slipped the heavy machine gun from his shoulder and rotated his arm, grimacing.
"That damn thing is like a sack of rocks," he muttered.
His voice was hoarse and guttural. 6 months earlier, a rocket fragment had caught him in the throat and nearly killed him. "You've seen nothing?" Rajim said disinterestedly. It was more of a statement than a question. He kicked absently at the hard ground.
"Of course I've seen nothing," Hamad growled, "because there's nothing to see, nothing."
A soft clattering of stones interrupted him, and they both glanced to the left to see a goat emerging from behind a large boulder. Two others followed it, hooves clicking on the rocks.
"Nothing," Hamad continued, "except these damn goats."
He picked up a stone and threw it at the lead billy, hitting it in the flank. The animal squalled and bolted off a few yards, then resumed its lazy meander through the rocks. Rajim drew on the last of his cigarette and flicked the butt onto the ground. He ran a hand through his tangle of black hair.
"I don't mind being on Mudin's personal guard," he said. "It's a lot safer guarding a Shiite holy man than doing penetrations and assaults on the coast. And we get fed decently. I'm tired of being shot at. Let some other fool get killed. I'm content to be bored here for a while."
Hamad snorted.
"A smell of goat dung is making me sick. I can't eat with it around me all the time. I was born in the city. Give me exhaust fumes any time."
They walked back to the archway and sat on the stone steps. Two more goats ambled by, nosing at the ground. One of them lifted its tail and defecated noisily. Hamad swore in disgust.
"You see?"
he said, the cigarette clamped between his lips, eyes squinting against the smoke.
"They just..."
He lay back suddenly, gently, on the stone of the top step. Rajim looked down at him in mild surprise. The cigarette was still clamped in his mouth, and his eyes were wide open. There seemed to be a dirty mark in the center of his forehead. Beneath his head, a dark, wet pool was spreading rapidly. Alarm began to register in Rajim's mind. It was the last thought he ever had. The dum-dum slug from the silenced 9mm pistol tore through his right eye and blew off the back of his head, spraying blood and brains on the wall of the archway. He slumped back beside Hamad without a sound. Four black figures fanned out from behind a huge boulder 30 feet from the steps, moving fast. All wore black-knit hoods and carried compact submachine guns. The lead figure also held a silenced automatic pistol in one hand. He and the man immediately behind him reached the wall first and flattened themselves on either side of the archway, weapons trained into the compound.
The last two went straight on through, split left and right when they entered the courtyard, crouched and covered the first two as they followed. Without a word, the four sprinted to the front door of the house. Two took up positions on either side of the door, and two continued along the wall of the house, ducking under windows as they worked their way around to the back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.